I met a dear saint of God back there that had never been much traveled in his life, wasn't highly educated, but he knew how to read the Bible, and he knew God. And we used to go out in the cemeteries in the cool of the evening to pray for the revivals in the little churches. And he walked in so close to God when he'd pray that it looked like he faced God face to face. And I'd heard him snub many a times in a little cry that he had so peculiar to him. And I've heard him tell God, "Lord, this is thy work, and we can't do a thing about thy work. And if thou canst afford to let thy work suffer, we'll have to let it suffer. And Lord, if you don't put your hand to your work, it's going to suffer." And I've seen God come in, and God move, and problems vanish away. The last time I drove out to see him, I was conducting a revival campaign at Sparta, Tennessee, in the Church of the Nazarene. I persuaded the pastor to drive me some 100 miles out on the mountain, out to Beersheba Springs, out through the spruce pines, down a long gully, and walked inside of a little chapel, for his wife said he's gone out to the little church to pray. He spends most of his days out there. I went in, and as I walked down, he said, "Who is it?" God had hung a shade over his old eyes till he couldn't see. I said, "It's Lawrence Hicks, Uncle Luther." He got up and put his feeble old arms around me and hugged me close. And he said, "Buddy, that's the way the mountain folk talk. You can get it so good that you won't want anything here, and you won't mind going home any time." It wasn't many months till in Erlanger Hospital in Chattanooga, he lay a dying. He talked to the nurses till a lot of them got religion. They lingered around his bed as he told them goodbye and changed the world. Somehow I felt all the afternoon, but I didn't want anything. I don't know what's wrong with me. I think if you'd have piled up $500,000 out there, I wouldn't have cared for it. Since about noon today, I haven't wanted a thing on earth. I don't know what it is. I felt like I had to tell you that. I know God wants to help us. Not only does he want to help us, but I know he is helping us. I haven't felt a spirit like this around the camp meeting in a long time. You better get your cup right side up. You better get your little problems out of the way. Better get ready to get right with God. He's in here. And he's crossing your pathway another time. And God's going to do something in Lakeland. And he said unto them, "Thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and arise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high." And he led them out as far as Bethany, and he lifted up his hands and blessed them. And it came to pass, while he blessed them, he was parted from them and carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and were continually in the temple praising and blessing God. Amen. Going into St. Louis, Missouri, some few years ago, on the train, I left my pastorate the night before in Ashland, Kentucky, and was riding the train into St. Louis. One of the men in St. Louis was to meet me down in the big Union Station, drive me immediately that Monday morning to one of the churches in Greater St. Louis. I was to speak three times that day in a Sunday school zone rally. I was to sleep a few hours and get in an automobile and drive 200 miles and speak three times the next day. And so on down across the week, three services a day, winding up sometime Friday night and back into St. Louis and a train ride all day Saturday and preaching two times the next Sunday. And as I rode into St. Louis that morning after I'd left my roomette, sitting there waiting to step off and be ready to go to the pulpit, I was praying and asking God to give me a message. I said, Lord, I want something that'll work in a big church or a little church. Yeah. I want something that'll work anywhere to get men to God. Looks like we're on a treadmill, Lord. We're going around in circles. Yeah. We've got the organization and churches everywhere of all denominations to do the job. We've got the personnel and the education. We've got the money. There isn't anything, humanly speaking, that we need that we don't have. We've the nice buildings and lovely pews. We've nice appointed pulpits. We've genuinely good men to fill them. We have good Sunday school teachers, well equipped, standing before their classes. But Lord, there's something we don't have. There's something that we need. There's something I need. That's the way I prayed to God that morning. He let me in on this, and this is the message I'd like to bring. It's here in the 24th chapter and the 49th verse of St. Luke's Gospel. And behold, I send. I'd like to pause on that send, the determination of it. Behold, I send the promise of the Father upon you. But tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem till ye be endued with power from on high. If I could analyze this crowd tonight, I think we'd fall out into 25 or 30 different denominations. If I could analyze it still further as to the clarity and the laity, I think we'd find a lot of ordained ministers here and a lot of good consecrated laymen. If I were to look down across this crowd tonight, I think I could reveal the hard agony of about all of us. Oh, God, we want to do something, and we don't quite know how we want to do it. I've been praying and asking God for this service tonight. God has something for us. I don't mean to say there's a third blessing awaiting us. I don't mean to charge you with being backslidden. I don't mean to charge you with walking back of light. But I do want to say that I'm afraid. A lot of us have embraced second blessing holiness with a mental assent and not with a heart grip and a reality. We've in this modern holiness movement, third and fourth generation of people. Last Sunday night, I think I baptized a fourth generation child into my church. The great-grandfather had been there, the grandfather, the father and mother, now this child, had been members of that church. We've gotten to where we've several generations in this modern holiness movement. Right here tonight, we have people that can remember the old days when the glory was down. We have people here tonight who can remember more modern days when the glory was down. We have folk here tonight that may have never seen the glory of God abide as some of the rest of us have, I don't know. But the thing I'm trying to get around to say is this, that whatever your problem is, God has the answer. If I were you, I'd go back home and preach Second Blessing Holiness, preacher friend. If I was you, I wouldn't go back and preach it foolishly or somewhere till folk could fight my foolishness. But I'd go to an altar of prayer and stay there till I got sanctified. Then I'd go back home and major on the theme of second blessing holiness. I wouldn't worry much about what folks said. God takes care of people pretty well. I'd make up my mind I wasn't going to quarrel with them, for it always takes two folks to raise a fuss. You and the other fella. And if you don't quarrel, he won't quarrel long.
I see.
And if you'll love, he'll soon get to love him.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
And if you'll not raise a lot of little side issues that God didn't put on them, and you can't substantiate in the Bible, but just go back and tell them there's a blessing that God wants to put in the heart that'll take carnality out of them, you'll have a holiness revival. Be gentle with people when you go back. Remember how hard God had to work on you.
Yes, sir.
Remember how blind you were, and maybe how stubbornly carnality dragged its heels in the sand.
Yes.
And don't get too quick to shove and pull and jerk and wrench and wrest and snatch. But if I were you, I'd go back home and have a holiness revival. I'll find out the reason why. Oh, Brother Hicks, I've got a preacher that don't preach second blessing holiness. Well, God knows that. Don't run around and tell everybody about it. They know he don't preach it too.
Yeah.
You get out and see if you can't pray for the fellow. And keep on praying and keep on praying and keep on praying till God builds a fire around him and there'll be some victory.
Yes, sir.
I remember a few years ago I was preaching in a southern city and it was rather cold weather. Down here when it gets cold, folk don't go to church. They shiver and stay at home. I remember that time I was in the southern city. It was January and got down to about 40, and we turned our collars up and shook a little bit and built fire out of lighter wood and stayed at home, most of us. But I preached some nights to as high as 6 and 7 and 8. There was a preacher got to come in of another denomination. He sat for 6 straight nights and watched me and drank in every word I preached. And on the last Friday night, he walked down to the pulpit, and he said, I appreciate your delivery. I appreciate your sincerity. I appreciate your handling of the scriptures. But I have listened to you preach this doctrine of entire sanctification 5 straight nights now, and I have made up my mind to come down and tell you I don't believe it. Well, I said, that's your privilege. I do believe it.
Yes.
Well, he said, I do appreciate you, and I'd like to have you as a friend, and we'd never met before. But he said, I don't believe that doctrine, and he walked out, and really, I thought he was gone. I went to my room, and about 10 o'clock, had my devotions, and laid my Bible down, and started to go to bed. And I couldn't go to bed. And I knelt beside that little sheet iron stove with a pile of pine knots to burn, and I prayed 30 minutes, and he came on me with a tremendous burden. I burned all my light knots up, and it was 12 o'clock, and I pulled a pillow off the bed to put my old knees on. And I've got a quilt and put around me, and had my clothes on, and it was getting cold, and 1 o'clock I was still praying. That preacher's face framed in front of me till I felt like I'd die if I didn't do something. 2 o'clock came, 2:30 came, about 2:45, there was such an agony, and all of a sudden it was gone. And I slipped out and in the bed and was asleep in 3 minutes. And the next morning I went back to preach on Saturday morning. And he came in and sat down when he said he wouldn't be back. And when I got through preaching, he came down and gripped me with both hands. And he said, I want to tell you something. I went home last night saying I didn't believe it and I couldn't go to bed. And in my parsonage with a Bible in one hand and John Wesley's journal in the other, I read and cried and prayed, and he said this morning at about 2:45, he sanctified me, and I've got the blessing. I don't know what part I had to pray in it, play in it, but I'm so glad I didn't go to bed that night. Beloved, I want to tell you tonight, I'm not preaching. I've laid aside sermonics and apologetics tonight. I want to tell you that Jesus can sanctify. I was preaching one night in Memphis, Tennessee, and out in front of me, there happened to be several ministers of various denominations. I preached on the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I just poured my heart out. That's all I've ever known to do. Greatest compliment anybody's ever paid me, Uncle Sam, you did it. Yesterday in your prayer when you said I didn't try to preach, I preached. That night I just preached. And I didn't say much, never do say too much. But when I got through and said, stand up, How many of you here want the blessing of entire sanctification? Presbyterian minister lifted his hand over here. Somebody lifted a hand over there. They started down the aisle, and soon the aisle was full. And I looked over, and here was a fine, brilliant, college-bred young lad of another denomination called to preach. And I walked over. He said, "My daddy preached that kind of doctrine." They gave him hard scrabble after hard scrabble till I got disgusted and said, "I'll never be a holiness preacher." He said, "I don't know whether it's the truth or not, but is it true what you preach tonight?" And I said, "You get on your knees, and I leave the answer with God.
Yes, sir.
If he tells you the truth, all right." He dropped on his knees, and I went over, and about that time, a Spanish lady prayed through with that end. And she got up testifying in a broken English and Spanish. You never heard anything like it in all your life. Blessed of God. I got through and walked back, and he was standing up, big tears running down his cheeks. He said, "It's the truth, and I've got it, and I'll preach it no matter where they send me. I'm going to preach second. Blessed be I'd been preaching in one of our lovely churches on a mountain. I closed the meeting, caught a train the next morning about 2:30, and started down into another part of the country. I was leaving my denomination to go to a college classmate to preach a revival in his church of another denomination. And I knew they didn't know anything much about regeneration at that church, let alone entire sanctification. I'd known a little something about it, with its beautiful Gothic architecture, its lovely vines climbing on the outside, its beautiful windows, its big circle open chancel. And the devil sat down in the pew beside me, or the seat beside me on the train. Said, "You've been preaching second blessing holiness there. What are you going to do when you get down to the next place and preach at 10:30 in the morning?" I kind of set my heels in the ground. "I know you think I can't ever do those kind of things, but there does come a time when I can." I said to the devil, "I'm going to preach holiness if God wants me to." Got down there, and my friend met the train, ran me to his parsonage, and I shaved without ever changing suits, went to the pulpit, bowed my head, and the Holy Ghost said, "Preach on second blessing holiness." Monday morning, I just preached out of my heart. Big, warm, moist tears trickled down my cheeks. I preached that night on it. I preached Tuesday morning and Tuesday night. I was burning up to give an altar call by then. I preached Wednesday morning and Wednesday night. I preached Thursday morning and Thursday night. I was about to die. I preached Friday morning. It was just a fraction past noon. There was a pervading of the very elixir of Canaan. There had dropped in a galvanic something. I bowed my head, and that voice I've learned to know said, "Now's the morning. Throw your net." And I said, "Everybody believes what I preach here and wants it. I want you to come down." And it startled me till I almost backed away. Like a wave of the ocean, a high tide, they moved. Just one breast of them down the aisles till every place was filled. Sobs, the most pitiful sobs I've ever heard. I heard a woman, a cultured, dignified southern lady, sob out, "Oh, God, for 4 days I've been dying. This morning at 4:15, Lord, I think I got through, but I know I'm through now." Presbyterian elder said, "Oh, God, I want this blessing," and he came up shouting about that time. Heaven broke along that long altar that morning.
Hey.
Went home to one of those lovely southern homes. Mrs. Hicks and I sat in the parlor. You don't call them living rooms in that kind of a home. We sat there as they prepared that nice smoked ham for dinner. That precious old lady, 75 or 80, walked over on the little settee and patted my hand and said, "Son, when I was a girl, my daddy drove me into the county seat town."
Yes.
"To hear a Methodist preacher called Beverly Carradine preach. And son, he preached just like you do. And don't you ever give that up. We've got to have it." they couldn't park the cars around. They heard and sought God. The next night they sought God. Sunday morning and Sunday night they sought God. Yeah. My daughter prayed through.
Praise God.
I'm going to give you something, he said. Yes, if you want it,
yes,
you can have it.
Yes.
Beloved, hear me tonight. God wants to give us the victory.
Right, right.
And God wants to sanctify people if we'll let him into our hearts.
Yes. Amen.
This group here, Jesus was leaving them. He'd already died on the cross for them. He'd given everything he could give. He'd given something better than silver and gold, according to Peter, his own precious blood. He provided an everlasting redemption. He was going to leave them. There was a handful of them left, and they were going out to tell others. And they were facing responsibilities and problems that nobody on earth could imagine. They had inner problems to face and outward problems to face. It hadn't been 3 weeks until ambition had gotten the upper hand of them. And in Matthew 20:20, they had had one of their mothers go round and pull political strings to get them the right seats in the kingdom of heaven. And he couldn't leave a bunch of folk like that to carry on his work. They'd be in church politics and they'd have the thing wrecked before he got back to heaven.
Yes, sir.
He had to get that inner problem out of the way.
Yes.
Then there was jealousy among them. In Luke the 9th chapter, in the 46 and 48 verses, they'd been arguing like a bunch of little children. They said, "I'm bigger than you." And the other one said, "No, you're not. I'm bigger than you." And he'd surmised their arguments and had rebuked them. And at the Last Supper, he'd just gotten up and slipped his outer garment off and girded him with a towel.
Yes.
And he, Son of the living God,
yes,
maker of the universe, sprinkler of every grain of dust, had dropped down on one knee and with a basin of water had taken the task of a menial, a task of a servant.
Yes.
And he had washed their feet.
Yes.
Don't you know that sermon in action went home that day?
Yes, sir.
Weren't they ashamed? He couldn't go in heaven and leave that thing in their breast that made them argue who's big and who's little.
Yeah.
He couldn't leave a world to be saved with a bunch of big eyes and little U's. He had to do something about it. Then they were so sectarian. In the 9th chapter of Mark, they'd found a man casting out devils. He didn't belong to their denomination. They'd stopped him. They stopped him short.
Yes, sir.
They said, "You don't follow with us and you don't take the communion like we do, and you quit that right now."
Yes, sir.
And I guess the poor crestfallen fella quit.
Yes.
And they came back bragging about it. And they had the audacity to brag about it to Jesus. And haven't you sometimes?
Uh-oh.
They said, "We found a fella not preaching like us. We stopped him." Jesus said, "Boys, brethren, you don't know what kind of spirit's in you. If he isn't for me, he's against me. And if he's for me, he certainly isn't against me. Why don't you leave him alone?"
Yeah.
He couldn't go back to heaven and leave a bunch like that to tell folk about his red blood running down Golgotha. He couldn't turn it over to the Nazarenes or the Pilgrims or the Wesleyans or the Methodists or the Presbyterians or the Baptists or somebody else. He had to get a crowd where they'd all tell about the same story when they got into some kind of a blessing. They were so immature. You know, immaturity of emotions is the thing that gets in a lot of folks' way. Peter had said, "Now the whole world may forsake you, but I've got a sword and I took a wet rock and sharpened it very sharp this afternoon. I stand between you and danger. They may all run out, but you count on me. Am I not the rock? Am I not the Petra? Don't I stand as a chip off the big old boulder? I'll be here." It wasn't 6 hours till he fled like the rest. And it wasn't him. Then he cringed in front of a little girl and swore with a bitter oath that he never knew him. That immature emotionalism. He couldn't go back to heaven, and we condemned Peter about it. But the record said they all forsook him and fled, the whole outfit. He couldn't go to heaven with a crowd that would get their emotions pumped up and have a shouting, eye-running time and then go out and do nothing about it. He couldn't go and leave it with that kind of a crowd. They were too immature. They needed something they didn't have. Then timidity infested them. They just were so timid. We got a lot of folk that get blessed, and it's all right to get blessed. I've had a time all this afternoon myself. I just got blessed. And I cried a little, shouted a little. It's good to get blessed. But we need something beyond that. They were so timid. Peter had said, I'm warming myself, now leave me alone. No, I don't know him. Oh, yes, you do. Your very speech betrays you. Well, I can go up to Minnesota or Boston or somewhere up there. They say, you're from the deep south, aren't you? You know how to tell? You know how to tell, just like we tell you Yankees, and you come down here. The speech betrays. That's exactly the way it happened. So he was out of Galilee with a broad, guttural dialect that wasn't real good Hebrew, and she could just tell, said, you're a Galilean, and that's where he came from. I think you were one of them. And he was so ashamed and so timid. We've got a lot of folk that don't know how to take a stand. And if they do take a stand, they take it so bitterly that they run everybody else off in that taking of their stand. Couldn't leave them like that. Then they were so nationalistic. They were the super race, if you please. And even beyond this, in Acts 1:6, they said, Lord, when you come back, will you restore the kingdom to Israel? We ought to be on the top of the stack, not Rome. It still hadn't penetrated them. We think we're the big ones today too, don't we? But he had to get that nationalism out of them, or the missionary endeavor would have died in Jerusalem. I heard Bishop Paul Kern remind the Tennessee Conference once. The bishop said, you call the Tennessee Conference the old Jerusalem Conference. But gentlemen, I want to remind you that the church almost died in Jerusalem. If there hadn't been some persecution, it would have died there. And so they were nationalistic. And we got a lot of folk like that. Oh, we are the folk that ought to rule the roost. And he couldn't carry on his missionary endeavor with that kind of an inner mess. Now, there's carnality for you. Have you followed me? Carnality with a rankling ambition that'll put him into church politics. Carnality with a rankling ambition in them that will make them jealous until if I can't play the piano, I'll go to somebody to let me play. And if I can't teach this class, I'll go to the other church and they'll give me one. And if I can't be the board member or the superintendent or the sexton here, I'll go to another church and they'll offer me a job. Are ye not yet carnal and walk as men? Did not the inspired St. Paul say in the Corinthian letter, chapter 3, while there are divisions and strife among you, are ye not carnal and walk as men? Carnality is a lot deeper than a little bit of the junk that we've preached off. Carnality is a lot deeper than a little bit of the externals we've legislated and ruled against. Carnality is something down in you that'll make you too ambitious and jealous. They'd have been so sectarian. Can you imagine those Pharisaical Hebrews folding their robes around them if he'd letting them go, let them go now and said, my, you're not our crowd. You can't get in. There was enough of them in that Doctor preached about the other day there in the 15th chapter of the Acts and said, we'll just make the whole outfit obey the law of Moses or they cannot be saved. Sectarianism and all those things, immaturity and timidity and nationalism. He had to get rid of those things before they could go out and be eyewitnesses to what they had seen. And may I lean across this pulpit and tell you tonight, and I believe God's telling me to tell it. If you and I don't get those inner problems corrected down in the innermost subterranean recesses of our souls, we'll never touch a lost well of hell-bound humanity. For Christ. Dr. R.A. Torrey, I believe it was, said that every prayer in the New Testament, the baptism of the Holy Ghost is mentioned. It is always associated with witnessing for soul winning.
Right.
And Charles G. Finney used to preach that if men failed to get sanctified when they had light and get the baptism of the Holy Ghost when they ought to, that a lost world would meet them at the judgment and their responsibility would be guilt for failing to get rid of their carnal nature and get the baptism that held them back from reaching a lost world. If you and I do not get sanctified, missionaries will fail.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. We are holding the lines and we won't send the stuff out and the sinews of war.
Right.
We'll be stingy. And we'll hold on to our bags of money and turn down the call of God to buy a few more nice living room suits and TVs and yachts and boats and big automobiles and while the world rolls in an ether of fire and get ready for a baptism of the fiery pits of an endless hell.
Right. Yes, sir.
Our sanctification is not a ring on a pie. It is not dessert at the end of a meal. It is coming to thrill you at a holiness camp meeting. That's just something pitched in for good measure.
Yes.
But it's something to give you the equipage and strap your blade and get you out there where you can do something and make an initial in the devil's shield of a lost world. Not only did they face those inner problems, but there were some outside problems that faced them too. He was going to catapult them, if you please. Toss them out, if you please, into a world of raving wolves. It would not be long till they would face the Stoics and the Epicureans. It would not be long till they faced the Aristotelian philosophers. It wouldn't be long till one of their number, out of their immediate number, but a comrade of their number, would stand at the marketplace on Mars Hill and face the most scintillating minds of ancient Greece. And they hadn't had the education to face the philosophy of Greece. For the Bible said in Acts chapter 4 and verse 12, I believe it is, 13 rather, they took knowledge of them, though they were ignorant and unlearned men, that they had been with Jesus.
Right.
And the word that is idiotes, and it's a word to get idiot from, and in the sight of the world, the little church was a bunch of maniacs and idiots, and that's all that was could be said. But when they went out with that burning witness of a baptized heart full of the Holy Ghost, they took knowledge of them, they walked with Jesus.
Yeah.
They couldn't face the rich estates of Galilee. dead. I couldn't let Marilou run in hell. I couldn't see those big blue eyes of Sudie's looking down into the fire of hell. I couldn't let that sunbeam of our home, little Nancy, that we've nicknamed Igago. I couldn't let her go to hell. But the devil's already got a slick toboggan grease.